It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world. You're in the sweet spot, baby. You're in the sweet spot, girl. You're in the sweet spot, darling. It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world.
Welcome to the Sweep Spot Podcast. My name is Lynn, your host, and Ken's my co-host. Ken, how's it going?
Oh, it is going. It is going. I am so happy to be here. I'm looking forward to this episode.
Yes, this is episode 335.
335? Oh, my. How's that possible? That's a lot of podcasts.
It is. That reminds me. I was looking through our library of podcasts, you know, and I was
our extensive library.
Yeah, and there's some really good interviews. Yeah, we're a little bit not seasoned in the podcasting at that time, but if you could look past that and listen to some of these interviews. We had some amazing people on there. I mean, we had Garner Holt, who was one of our first big, you know, interviews we did. It's just some really good stuff. So, you know, don't look past those. I've noticed, you know, I can see the downloads, and those first, like, year or two, the downloads are hardly there. So, and there's a lot of good stuff there. So go back and check out our libraries are all available. So
even though we weren't seasoned podcasters, we were still former Disneyland foremen, you know, who are sharing our insights into the history and the current happenings at the Disneyland Resort.
Yeah.
So if you want our perspective that you don't get anywhere else, then you know we've always had that as part of the podcast.
Yeah, I would say even more in those beginning years where we told more of our stories working there. That was before the books came out. And because we didn't have an idea that we were going to, so I thought, man, we got to tell these stories. But then, you know.
We do have two books out.
We do. We have two books out called Cleaning the Kingdom. There's a volume 1 and 2. And you can get those on our website signed by both of us at thesweepspot.com. You can also get them on Amazon, not signed. And you can get them on Kindle, the audiobook for the first one is available where audiobooks are found. Audible, I believe, is the best place to get it. The second book, the audiobook, is coming out this summer. This summer, late, early fall. probably more like that, like fall. But we're working on it, and it should be out then. Also, if you'd like to help support the show, we have a Patreon where people become Patreons of the show, and they can help support us and help support the show and our expenses that keep going up. We have levels where if you just like to give $1 a month.
Can you imagine if everybody listening gave at least $1? I mean,
I could quit my job. No, just kidding. that would really be helpful. But if you want to give more than that, and there are people that do, you can get some great things in return. We have a bonus show that we do once a month, and it's not just our typical show. It's more of a casual conversation, just Ken and I talking about subjects, variety of different topics to do with Disneyland, and they're really fun to record. And also, we do once a month, we do our recording of our current events, which is our news for the Disneyland Resort news. And we record it live where you can join in with the chat. So you can give a comment on a topic, you know, we're talking about during the current events, and we'll read those comments. Not all of them, but we read probably most of them.
We have to be worthy.
Yeah.
But you know, but we do it live. I mean,
we do it live.
That's right.
And it's fun. We, you know, a few minutes before we record, we always have, you know, people ask us questions or just have a little chit chat, and it's a lot of fun. So if you'd like to do that, you go to patreon.com, search the Sweep Spot, or you go to thesweepspot.com, and there's a Patreon link there. You can sign up and be a reoccurring donor for that at $5 or more, and you get those great things we just talked about. Speaking of that, the next one we're going to do is Friday, June 10th at 8 p.m. Pacific time. And I will send out a link. If you join the Patreon, you'll get a link sent to you as a reminder, and you'll use that link to listen in to us there. Someday we'll add video, but we're still new to this, so probably sometime...
We have the perfect faces for podcasts.
We really do. So. And then real quick, we'll be at D23 Expo in September. I believe Saturday's sold out, but I think you can still get singled tickets for Friday and Sunday. So we will be there. Yeah.
We had kind of a test run of that.
We did.
You know, lately.
Yeah, we were at the Disneyana Show and Sell, 2 weeks ago in mid-May. And we were there selling our books, and we were giving out buttons to listeners, and we saw plenty of our listeners that were there. There was actually a fellow and his daughter came from a town called Hurricane, which is right next to St. George, just a suburb of St. George. And I am so sorry, I can't remember your name at the moment, but they came out and they chatted with us, and I know we met a lot of people that day.
You could have gotten away without mentioning Madeline.
Well, you know, I wanted to be honest, but we met a lot of people that day, and I can't remember everyone's name, but I remember.
Memory's the second thing to go, so yeah.
I remember the face though, and there you go. And it was a lot of fun to meet you both. So thank you so much for coming out.
Thanks to everybody who stopped by. That was great.
It was a lot of fun. So what else happened that day? We had a special guest stop by, didn't we?
Well, yes, we did. You're talking about Mark Marcuse. No, you're talking about Ray Sedejas.
I am.
Ray Sedejas, the top Janny.
Yeah, Ray, who we've talked about in our books, and we've had him on our show, and he was our manager when we were working there.
He stopped by. We tweeted out some pictures with him, and it's great. We were pretty close to where Terry Harden and Bob Gurr were.
Yeah,
you know, close to Dave Bossert and Dave Koenig.
Yeah.
So we were. It was great to be there. You should have been there if you weren't. But you know what? Don't make that mistake again. Come see us at D23.
That's right. This may be your last chance. No, just kidding.
are you planning something
that I'm just saying that the okay. The events you never know when we
you never know
yes. These events, you know, so I mean, anyways, it was a lot of fun, and we hope to do this again with Disneyana. Is just a great organization. So Ken, who is our guest tonight?
Well, we have Val Usle, who was an architect, and he worked with a lot of he worked on a lot of stuff that people will recognize.
Oh yeah.
But he also, before that, before he became an Imagineer, he was a monorail driver. So he's got some great stories about that, and I think our listeners will enjoy listening to him.
Yes.
So yeah, just you want to catch this one, and you want to stay tuned to the end, because we always have important things to say after we're done with our main topic.
Always. All right. Well, we have a lot going on, so we want to get right into our current events.
Thank you.
Now we're going to have the current events. Ken, what do you have for us?
Well, Lynn, I have a few things.
Okay.
Yes. Sometimes we become a little bit like Universal Studios, and apparently Radiator Springs Racers tried to pull Universal Studios. Let's get right to it. Disneyland's Radiator Springs Racer ride closed for holiday weekend. And this was a Marla Jo Fisher story out of the Orange County Register. I think Brady might have been otherwise occupied. It says here, from May 26th, Radiator Springs Racers, the centerpiece of the Disney California Adventure Park's Cars Land, was closed late Tuesday, and by late Tuesday she means the 24th, for investigation after witnesses said they saw smoke coming out of one of the vehicles after it crossed the finish line. So, isn't anyone allowed to smoke anymore, for crying out loud? Okay. The Disneyland spokesperson, a Disneyland spokesperson, confirmed that there was an issue with a single vehicle, and the ride was closed all day Wednesday. It will remain closed indefinitely, quote, out of an abundance of caution, end quote. The Disneyland spokesperson said the guests, quote, might see visible testing over the weekend, end quote. And by the weekend, they mean the Memorial Day weekend. Mm-hmm. So it's, the unofficial start to summer. It's busy, lots of people, So there you go.
That's unfortunate because that's a ride that takes up a lot
takes a lot of people. It's very popular. Mm-hmm. But as David Koenig pointed out, it's not, now that they've got Avengers Campus, it's not their primary marketing focus for the park. So that's
true. Yeah.
That's at least true. Laughing Place also covered that story. So if you want to click through to get the details, you can. Mm-hmm. All right. I'm ready for some music. How about you, Lynn?
I am always ready.
All right. Well, as Brady McDonald did report in the Orange County Register, by the way, folks, all these stories are available at our website, the current events show notes, so you can click through and read the entire thing if you're of that ilk or inclination, I should say. The Soul of Jazz exhibit coming to Downtown Disney celebrates Black history. And as Brady McDonald reported, a new music exhibit coming to Downtown Disney that pays tribute to Black history in America and the Oscar and Grammy winning animated film Soul explores the legacy of jazz in New Orleans, Harlem, Kansas City, and across the United States. The Soul of Jazz, an American adventure touring exhibit, will run from June 1st through July 4th at the former ESPN Zone in Downtown Disney as part of Disneyland's continuing Celebrate Soulfully campaign. Admission is free to Downtown Disney visitors. Cool. So, there you go. The touring exhibit started out at the American Adventure attraction at Disney's Epcot theme park in Florida and has made stops at the New Orleans Jazz Museum, American Jazz Museum in Kansas City, and National Jazz Museum in Harlem. Nothing about it stopping by the Utah Jazz, though, so I don't... I'm sorry, Lynn, that it didn't do that. Walt Disney Imagineering worked with the cultural institutions and music experts to create the exhibit. Imagineering tailored the exhibit to reflect local jazz history and culture at each stop, with each museum adding artifacts from its unique collection. The Soul of Jazz exhibit runs during Black Music Month as part of Disneyland's Celebrate Soulfully campaign, which celebrates the work of Black artists through dance, music, food, and stories. Throughout the exhibit run, R&B, jazz, funk, Motown, and doo-wop groups will play during the evening on the Downtown Disney stage next to the former ESPN Zone and Star Wars Trading Post. All right.
Sounds good.
And the official Disney Parks blog also covers that story. And they point out that beginning May 28th, Disneyland Park will welcome Tale of the Lion King to its new home at the Fantasyland Theater. So there's a lot happening as of May 28th at the resort.
Yeah.
As we will see. I always love the legalese that they always have at the end of these official Disney park blogs updates, you know, with theme park reservations and valid admission for the same park and the same day are required for park entry. Park reservations are limited, subject to availability, not guaranteed. Entertainment, experiences, and offerings may be modified, limited in availability, or unavailable, and are subject to restrictions and change or cancellation without notice. Park admission and offerings are not guaranteed. Visit Disneyland.com/updates for important information to know before visiting. Anyway.
To avoid lawsuits, yeah. So is that show, I mean, it's good because with Fantasmic coming back and that, and it's like we're getting slowly almost back to normal, right?
Back towards full capacity.
Yeah.
Yes. Speaking of lawsuits that you just mentioned.
Okay.
The Orange County Register, Brady McDonald, does report. Judge allows Disney pass holder lawsuit to move forward. See, that's part of the problem is they call it pass holder. It's not called a pass. It's called a key.
Yeah.
It's a magic key. And I'm certain that the reason they call it a magic key is part of what's going to be part of their defense in this lawsuit. Okay. Because they deliberately called it something other than the annual pass because they wanted to say this is a new set of rules.
Right.
And as it says in the story here, a federal judge has allowed a Disneyland pass holder lawsuit to move forward that claims the Anaheim theme park misled and deceived its most loyal fans by artificially limiting capacity and restricting reservations, according to court documents. The complaint filed by Disneyland Magic Key annual pass holder Janali Nielsen of Santa Clara County has been working its way through the court process since November of 2021. Disneyland sought to have the case dismissed in early March, and a Central District of California judge issued a ruling in early April dismissing 4 of Nielsen's 6 allegations in the suit, but allowing the other 2 to move forward. Disney lawyers answered the complaint in late April, and Nielsen's attorneys filed an amended complaint on May 10. The lawsuit alleges that Nielsen purchased a $1,399 Disneyland Dream Key annual pass. See, the story keeps calling them annual passes.
Yeah,
but that's,
yeah.
With no blockout dates in September 2021. But was unable to make theme park reservations for certain dates in November 2021. Nielsen's attorneys are seeking to have the case certified as a class action by the U.S. District Court, a step that has not yet happened. Of course they're seeking to make it class action.
Right.
You ever get these? You ever get anything in the mail that says that you might... Yeah, you know what you're going to get? You're going to get like $2.
Right.
And the lawyers are going to get a lot of money if they're successful. That's the way the class actions often work.
It's often
not even worth your effort. You know?
Right.
Unless you're the lawyer. Say, who writes most laws anyway? Okay. The $5 million suit filed against Walt Disney Parks and Resorts on behalf of all Magic Key annual pass holders alleges Disneyland relegated them to second-class ticket holders by artificially limiting Magic Key reservations and the number of pass holders that could visit on any given day. In other words, what they want, what the person suing is saying they should do is, as long as they're going to be letting anybody in that day, they should be allowing the key holders.
I get it, yeah.
As you'll see, United States District Court Judge David Carter denied Disney's motion to dismiss the Magic Key annual passholder case as it relates to breach of contract and the California Consumer Protection Act. Carter granted Disney's dismissal motions relating to claims of false advertising, negligent misrepresentation, legal disclosure, and unfair competition. The California Consumer Protection portion of the case will likely hinge upon whether a Disneyland Dream Key annual pass constitutes a good or service, as Nielsen's lawyers contend, or a temporary license, as Disney contends. Another key contention, the meaning of blockout dates and what that definition includes and excludes for pass holders at Disneyland. Quote, plaintiff alleges that the term no blockout dates is not defined in the advertisement, but that she understood the term to mean that Dream Key pass holders would not be blocked out from making theme park reservations whenever Disney was offering park reservations for entrance to the park theme parks, according to the complaint. So in other words, they're saying that, you know, you shouldn't be blocking out your pass holders if you're still selling tickets to other people.
Right.
That's what they're not.
Yeah. That's day tickets, or whatever they call them.
Yeah. And as further on in the story, Disneyland sold out of the top price Dream Key in October 2021 amid howls from angry pass holders due to the widespread lack of reservations available for the $1,399 pass with no blockout dates. The $949 Believe Key sold out in November 2021. The $649 Enchant Key and $399 Imagine Key remain available. Yeah. So,
what do you think, Ken?
Well, I think Disney normally is very, very careful about how they do these things. They usually have all their I's dotted, all their T's crossed. And it's going to be interesting to see, because they actually admit, no, we don't define what blockout date, what it's meant by no blockout date. But so it is going to hinge on whether it's a temporary license. Because Disney says, hey, look, this is just a temporary license. When you buy this, it doesn't actually guarantee you anything, other than it's a license so that you don't have to pay additional fees to, if you get a reservation. And what the holder, the suit is alleging is, hey, you sold a good or service that we can't use.
Right. I get that.
And you said no blockout dates, but I'm being blocked out even though you're still letting other people buy tickets.
But because they didn't define it, that could go in their favor because they didn't define it, right?
Well, yeah, I mean, it's going to be interesting to see how it shakes out. I think Disney could just, and I think I kind of talked about this before, I think they could move beyond this and just sell in bulk, sell admission in bulk. Okay. Mm-hmm. Like how much does a 5-day ticket cost or whatever, And if you just add a little extra cost onto the, if you sell like 10 admissions together and you price it, at a discount that it's cheaper than buying one day at a time or whatever.
Right.
And then, so it becomes a way that someone who does want to go many times in a year can go for a lot less than it would be if they were paying for a single day ticket every time. And that, if you sell it that way, if you sell it in bulk, say, oh, it's a 10-day admission ticket, you get around this whole debate about, I have an annual pass and I can't use it, or I have a magic key and I can't use it. You put maybe a 3-year limit on it. You say you have to use these days within the next 3 years or whatever.
Or even within a year, if you, Angel Stadium has a thing called like a 20-game plan, so you get to pick 20 games. I think you have to pick them up front, like which ones you want to go to. But And obviously that would be hard to do. Like, say if you had the 50-day plan for Disneyland, like, it would be hard to plan out 50 days over a year. But if you could use those 50 days however you wanted, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
you still have to make reservations, but you have, but you can use those 50 days however you wanted and priced it at 50 or 100 or 200, you know, and have like, for me, I would buy like a 10 day plan, you know?
Yeah.
And it would be priced at that, because, you know, they sell up to 5 day tickets.
Right.
So they could price it out any way they want, and they could make it, you know, a 10 day, a 20 day, 50, 100. And I think they should have one that has no reservations required. Like, you don't need to make reservations. You can show up whenever you want, but make that pass like $3,000. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
$3,500 or something huge.
Yeah.
I don't know. Just, I get why they're doing the lawsuit, because it is kind of misleading if you're like, oh, I'm paying $1,400 so I can have no blockout dates. But you can't get,
right.
But you can't get in on, you know, so I understand that. All right.
Yeah. Like I said, I you know, just make it
yeah.
Sell in bulk and you know, so it's essentially the same thing, but the difference is people are paying up front. There's no monthly payments. You know, I don't know. We'll have to see how it shakes out. They know what they're doing.
It'll be interesting when August comes, because all the people that bought the passes the first day they were available will soon be. I don't remember the day they went out. August 16th.
See how many people renew or whatever.
Or how the whole renewal process will go. Like, are they going to let the Dream Key, which they don't sell anymore? Are they going to let them still have the Dream Key, you know?
Oh, that's a good question. I mean, obviously it behooves Disney to sell, you know, to try to get as many people to come to the park,
right,
and spend as much money as they can. And you don't want to upset the people so that they give up on it, you know?
Yeah, because those are the loyal fans that keep coming back. And I know.
And a lot of them buy really expensive items.
Right. And they still, you know, buy food. They collect.
Yes. Right. They buy food, they buy really expensive collectibles, a lot of them.
A lot of popcorn, a lot of popcorn buckets, right?
Yeah.
So they can sell them on eBay. No.
Sell them on eBay,
but,
yeah.
But yeah, no, I always remember hearing that, like, you know, I never heard Disney say this, but that Disney didn't like pass holders because they just came and took up space but didn't spend money. But like we had just said, I don't
think. Well, they do. The one time in a lifetime or one time in several years visitor, mm-hmm, usually will spend more money,
right?
You know, because they're gonna, like, I always try to not eat. I try to keep my visits short and not eat there.
Right.
You know? But if you have somebody who's there for, you know, 5 days or whatever, and that's their only time they're going to be there for the foreseeable future, you know, they're going to probably be eating two or three meals a day on Disney property and, you know, that sort of thing. I mean,
yeah, you gotta know how to, what items you can buy and what's good and what's a good deal and what, you know.
Yeah.
So, all right.
All right.
We can do a whole bonus episode on.
Well, you know, if you think key holders or magic keys, mm-hmm, are shady, well, there's some fun stuff going on in the city of Anaheim. I'm not going to get too deeply into it because it's a really long story.
Okay.
But there is a story that was in the Register called from Alicia Robinson that says, "Allegations paint picture of influential cabal in Anaheim politics." Ooh. And the mayor of Anaheim, who seemed to be very pro-Disney, resigned. There's an FBI investigation, and it has mostly to do with the stadium that the Angels play at. Mm-hmm. I believe the I might have my facts a little mixed up. I'm not sure, but I believe the city of Anaheim owns like the stadium and the land around it, and they're trying to get the Angels to commit to staying in Anaheim by selling the land to them.
Oh, right. I think so, yeah.
And but Disney's all tied up in this too, because it's like, well, look at all the influence Disney was. Now, if Disney really had that much influence, then Disney would have ended up with that property, you know.
Right.
But of course Disney has influence. I mean, if you go back and look at the old aerial photographs of Anaheim in 1954 1955.
There's nothing else.
It was, you had farms, you know. Anaheim would just be another suburb of the Los Angeles area if it wasn't for Disneyland. Now, granted, now it has all, I mean, it has manufacturing, you know, it has it has the Anaheim Stadium, it's got the Honda Center arena, and it's, you know, it's got the convention center, but
all that wouldn't exist if Disney,
it basically started with Disneyland, and of course Disneyland has influence. Now, the difference is, though, you cannot run a city like a private business, right? Mm-hmm. In a private business, you can meet with whoever you want to meet with. You can, you know, privately held. I'm not talking shareholder corporation. I'm talking just like a privately owned business. You can meet with whoever you want to meet with. You can make deals. You can, you know, do all that sort of thing, right? Mm-hmm. A city, a city government, you know, various meetings have to be public, you know, and the finances, the money's not yours. The money belongs to the people of the city. So, you know, there's certain rules and regulations that you have to go by. And if you do things kind of if you do certain things privately, you know, things that you would not do privately if you're running a business, you can't do if you're in charge of a city. You know, it's got to be some stuff has got to be a public, on the record, all kinds of stuff. So anyway, if you're interested in all that intrigue, it's in the news. We'll have a link to it and you can click through. It's gonna be interesting to see how that all shakes out. Now, what I'm hoping, you know, a lot of other Disney fans are hoping, we would love to see because because if you ever, you can go take a look on it on Google Maps or whatever. The stadium is in the middle of this big block of land, and it's basically parking, flat parking around it.
Yeah.
And it's right off of a freeway, in between two exits of a freeway. And, you know, if Disney got a hold of that land, with or without the stadium, because the idea was build a new stadium, tear down the old one, and build parking structures, and then take all the extra land there, and, you know, you can build, you know, restaurants and whatever.
Yeah.
I mean, people are saying, well, what if Disney got a hold of that? You know, they could put another theme park there or whatever. I think they could do all kinds of stuff with it, but maybe that's the details of that are probably for later for something else. But it's going to be interesting to see how that shakes out, because everything's been kind of put on hold from, you know, there was a deal set up with the Angels, and other cities are saying, hey, come play for us. You know, like the city of Long Beach.
Yeah.
Yeah. The Long Beach Angels. So, Laughing Place also has coverage of that. And they say, as they say, the employee of the firm called Company A in the affidavit, that's part of a federal public corruption probe, helped script a statement read by an elected official before the city council voted to issue bonds and provided input on whom to invite to a covert retreat for community power brokers. So like I said, certain things, you can't have private meetings for certain things. But anyway, Company A is Disneyland Resort, according to a person familiar with the investigation. And the employee is Disneyland Resort Director of External Affairs, Carrie Nocella. Though neither the company nor Nocella have been accused of wrongdoing, their connection to the wide-ranging investigation that led to Mayor Harry Sidhu resigning underscores, pardon me, excuse me, All choked up. Yeah, sorry about that, folks. The immense influence the company wields in the city of 350,000, with a budget fueled by millions of visitors each year to the Disneyland Resort. So anyway,
All right.
Now, MiceChat.com had a bunch of updates since we last recorded. You have one from May 9th, Disneyland news update, feeling the force of change. So, and they have, who did that update? Oh, that was Mike Kendrick, because other people weren't available, so he did that. MiceChat.com also had Disneyland Resort news, red car trolley to return, and more good news, and that was from Dusty Sage on May 12th. There was an Andy Castro update from May 16th. It was Disneyland update, rise and fall, the rapid pace of change. So, they're talking about some of the construction work going on there. Mm-hmm. Dusty Sage also had a May 23rd update. Disneyland update, the cost of magic and Project Gateway. So, it does say here, Genie Magic at what cost? So, because they were able to, you know, during some of the reports on earnings, they were talking about how many people are spending money on Genie Plus.
Right.
Also, Dusty Sage had a May 26th report. Disneyland News. Mm-hmm. Radiator Springs Racers incident and Blue Bayou return info. So, the Blue Bayou will be coming back. You know, I know that's not a surprise if you thought it was going away, you know.
Right.
But they mentioned the Raider Springs incident that we talked about. And finally, MiceChat also has something updated May 27th called Disneyland Spectaculars and Entertainment Return, Everything You Need to Know. So they talk about the Electrical Parade, World of Color, Disneyland Forever Fireworks, Fantasmic, Tale of the Lion King, and yeah, so... lots and lots to keep updated on, and
I wonder why they didn't bring Fantasmic back tonight.
By tonight. See, people listen to us at different times. You're referring to Friday, May 27th.
Yeah, they always bring opens things on a Friday usually. I wonder why.
Yeah, that's very curious. Maybe it has to do with the 5-year contract. No, that's an old joke. I don't know what, why. That's weird.
Yeah.
You know.
All right.
So, but that's going to be interesting because it's been a while since they've had Fantasmic, and that's always a big crowd thing. And
yeah, it's going to bring crowds back to the. Not that there weren't crowds on the west side of the park, but it's just going to bring more. But the good thing is with. Galaxy's Edge now. I know that they had Fantasmic with Galaxy's Edge before the shutdowns, but I always thought that's a good thing because you can avoid, you know, say if you're over at Splash Mountain or Haunted Mansion, you don't have to go through the Fantasmic crowds to get to Fantasyland or the other parts of the park. You know, you can go through Galaxy's Edge and then out on the trail there. I don't know. Anyway.
That is a good point.
Yeah.
The crowd flow dynamics are a little bit different than
It's good.
Than they were for most of Fantasmic's 30-year existence. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
All right.
All right. So, what do you have as far as renovations?
Well, not a whole lot of different. The Blue Bayou is scheduled on the Disneyland app to come back June 24th. But there's, according to MiceChat, Dusty was saying that it's possible they will do a soft opening this weekend or next weekend. And that would be no reservations required, and it's just walk-up, something like that. So Disney hasn't come out and said that, but that's just what... MiceChat reported. I think the walls are still up in around the water, though. So that does take away a little bit of the ambiance there, but Pirates. Now, according to the Disneyland app, it's going to be back open on July 1st, but Disney has not come out and said that this is when it's coming back. Unless you take the app as Disney coming out and saying it's coming back, you know, because it's closed on the 30th and then it's under the refurbishment list, but on the 1st, it's not there anymore. So I think that will be the day it opens, but they haven't said officially. Because it's easy just to change something in an app or a website. But once you announce it, then it's out there in multiple places, you know. Because news places pick it up and stuff. Finding Nemo subs, no return date. But that could change because the water is in the lagoon now. So I don't know what else there is left to do except for just running the subs through the... You know, make sure the actual subs are running properly, because as far as painting and doing things, they wouldn't have filled it up if they still had more to do with that. But the walls are still up and the water's filled in the lagoon. So we'll see. I mean, that could change because the Disneyland calendar goes all the way to like mid-July or almost the end of July now, and it's still showing Finding Nemo, which is really weird, because at one point it was supposed to come back in the winter so of last year. Let's see, Treehouse, no return, but I've noticed in some photos that the tree stump thing that was like attached to the bridge is mostly gone now. There's like some things still, like rebar or whatever, still there, but it's mostly gone now. And I noticed some people are upset about this is ridiculous, you know. Now New Orleans is going to be visible from Adventureland. What would Walt say about this, you know? And the thing is that part of the tree has only been there since 1999.
Right.
Before that, for how many years, it was not there. So, yeah. Just a reminder.
I can't wait till that is auctioned off at the Von Eaton Galleries.
I don't know. You know, there's a lot of missed opportunities. They could probably, that bridge, they could cut up little pieces of wood, and people would buy it. Isn't it, that's right, don't you think? Yeah. So that's happening, and then you mentioned Radiator Springs Racers, so I'm not that's not like on their refurb calendar, but it's actually wiped from existence, like the erased.
This attraction never existed.
Yeah, like on the Disneyland app on the map, it doesn't even list the ride. It's just a blank.
Oh, wow. They must really be in trouble.
It's been erased. Erased from existence.
Like Toontown.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I also wanted to mention some things real quick because we'll talk a little. You know, we had already talked a little bit in our introduction about the Disneyana part of it. Because Ken was there for that, and I was too. But Ken was not there for the other 2 days prior to that. I had showed up to... I had a really bad migraine when I showed up Friday night. I got there Friday. I had worked Friday morning. Got in my car, drove 6 hours. You know, got there, and I had a really bad headache, and allergies were bothering me. And so I took a nap. But I ended up meeting up with some friends, Teresa and Tag from DL Weekly, and we got to hang out, had some beignets when I first met up with them, and then we went on a few rides, and then ate dinner at the Plaza Inn restaurant. And usually I get the chicken there, because that's kind of their famous for, but I actually had the salmon there, and it was actually really good.
Wow.
I just wanted to change it up. I didn't feel like anything really fried at that moment. I don't know why. Hung out with them. Saw another listener after that. Chatted. And then tried to go on Rise of Resistance, and it broke down halfway in the line.
Oh, boy.
So we got out of line. Anyways, I went Saturday, and I was on my own Saturday. And it was actually a lot of fun. I utilized the single rider lines.
The ones that still exist.
Yeah, and then when you're single, you could zoom through things quicker. You know, you don't have to discuss your next plan with whoever you're with. You just go. And there was a couple, a lady and a man that had said that, I was on Star Tours, and I sat, you know, there, and she was next to me, and she said, oh, you're on your own. I said, yeah. She said, I bet you get on a ton of rides by yourself. I said, oh, yeah. So I was just making the rounds there. I did get Genie Plus for that day because I wanted to see how that worked and then utilize in the single rider line. So I actually got on a lot more. I don't remember how many, but I did all I wanted. But it was really hot that day. It was like 95 degrees or something. And so I did a lot of things like Mr. Lincoln, which I hadn't done in a long time, so I went in there and sat in the theater. I kind of looked around in the lobby and missed the showing. Like, right when I walked in, they were loading for a show. But I wanted to see the, you know, all the displays, so I just hung out. Yeah. I love that place. Anyways, it's really neat. So that's a good place to go when you're hot and you just want to relax for a little bit. And it's a good show. I mean, it's obviously. So I did that, but I had a good time. Just did a lot of stuff while I was there. And then on Sunday, you know, we had Disneyland. We'd already talked about that. But then Sunday night, I went back in the park because I have the magic key, so I'm able to, you know, make reservation ahead of time, and I was able to go in. So I went in and met up with some other friends from the Rope Drop podcast, and hung out with them, had dinner, went on a couple rides, and then I split because I was getting tired. The Disneyland, you know, we were there all day. So it was funny though. They were like, they wanted to see the electrical parade, and it was going to start in like 15 minutes. And I said, well, I don't know. Good luck finding a spot. Because they announced on the thing, you know, on the speakers that, you know, the showing is now full. You know, come back for the 10:45, you know. And I said, I don't think you're going to find a spot. And then they're like, yeah, we are. You know, they were determined. So I said, well, I'm going to hang out with you just to see if you find a spot. I'm not going to actually watch the parade. I'd seen it enough, and I just didn't want to. And they squeezed in and got the best prime spot, like on Town Square, directly in front of the flagpole, like right there. So anyways, that was funny. So anyways, had a good trip, enjoyed being at the resort, and I think that's all I have for that without going into too much detail.
Wow.
But you know, the parks are harder to navigate now, aren't they, Ken?
They are. They're a little bit harder to navigate. There's a lot of things that are changing. The rules of the game are changing. And, you know, as you might have noticed from our last main episode, you know, sometimes those of us old fogies who are used to the rules the way they were before are having a hard time adjusting. Well, that's what Concierge is for. So if you want to plan your next Disney getaway vacation to Disneyland or Walt Disney World, the Disney Cruise Line, Disney's Alani in Hawaii, Adventures by Disney, whatever Disney destination you want to go to concierge.com. That's concierge.com. Go there, let them know what you're thinking about, and start planning your next Disney getaway vacation with them, because they're our magical vacation planning partners. They know what's going on, what all the changes are. They know how to get you reservations. it's going to take the stress out of your planning your trip, but it's not going to cost you any more than it would otherwise. They're not adding any cost to your trip. So go to concierge.com. Tell them that you want to go to a Disney destination. Book with them a package, like, you know, like the cruise line for a week, or theme park tickets and a hotel stay, a package, and let them know that the Sweep Spot sent you. And if you do that, you'll get a special gift.
They may say, who? You
know, they'll go, who? No, you know, I send my own mother to Concierge. Mm-hmm. And she's been to Walt Disney World so many times. But I tell her, go, you know, plan your next trip with Concierge. And so, really, we recommend them. We recommend them so much, Lynn started doing some work for them. So who knows? Maybe you'll end up with Lynn. But it's, you know, it's a no-brainer to me. And I want to thank them for their ongoing support of the podcast. And I highly recommend them.
Sounds good.
Hello, everyone. This is Eric Johnson with Concierge, and welcome to the D180. While Ken and Lynn cover all things Disneyland, in the D180, we take a spin around the rest of the Disney universe, and we do it in 180 seconds. So let's jump right in. We begin our adventure this week in the Walt Disney World Resort, where Epcot is finishing up its Flower and Garden Festival run. What's next? Yep, it's the Food and Wine Festival starting this July. This is the big one every year, the festival that started in a hotel conference center over a weekend and has grown to 128 days this year. We are now privy to the guest list for the festival's Eat to the Beat concert series. Fans of music from the 80s and 90s are in for a treat with some festival favorites coming back to the stage. Baha Men, Big Bad Voodoo Daddy, Christopher Cross, Not Enough, Hooba Stank. That do it for ya? Fine. Hanson, Boys to Men. Seriously, this festival is known for its great music most nights of the week. Tiffany, Billy Ocean. If you want to stake out the best spots for your favorite acts, you have several options to eat to the beat. No, that's not my pun. Remember, the Eat to the Beat series of dining packages lets you enjoy a nice meal and reserved seating for the night's shows. Make reservations in Germany, Canada, Morocco, the American Adventure, the Land Pavilion, or the Living Seas. All really great options for a meal with a chance to see your favorite acts up close. Also, the new Guardians ride just opened, but you know all about that, right, listener? Of course you do. So let's head eastward to the fields outside Paris. Disneyland Paris inches ever closer to a major upgrade this July. Coming soon, start with a briefing from Captain Marvel and Iron Man, and your family will be a part of the action. Special photo pass moments, extra meet and greets with your favorite Marvel heroes, and new rides await. This new area at the Walt Disney Studios Park looks like they took the DCA Avengers campus and punched it up a few notches. All of the best moments are there, with vehicles and innovative locations to meet your heroes. There will also be two rides, one a version of Web Slingers from DCA, and the other a simulator that will take you and Iron Man on a mission against a planetary threat. Or I guess you could go to Epcot and ride the Guardians of the Galaxy Cosmic Rewind. Seriously, can't wait. I won't be there for a few more weeks, but I'm looking forward to racing to the new coaster at Rope Drop a few times on my trip in June. Really, the concept is fantastic. We have a new pavilion, the Wonders of Xandar Pavilion, where we can pretend that Peter Quill and all of his friends were part of the Epcot universe from the start. The Guardians of the Galaxy are real and visited Epcot back in the 80s. Ultimately, this is a coaster most of the family will enjoy. There's story, there are thrills, there are great effects. This looks like it's going to be amazing. And that's 180 seconds. I hope you enjoyed our quick spin around the rest of the Disney universe. If you would like to learn more about these Disney adventures or just have a few questions, please come on over. Visit the social media and websites of both the Sweep Spot and us, their official travel planners concierge. We look forward to planning something special for you and your family. I'm Eric Johnson, and this has been your D180.
Okay, Val, did you grow up going to Disneyland? Was it something that was part of your childhood?
I think growing into it is a better description. I was born in Minnesota back in the 50s when Eisenhower was president. And so my folks moved out to California when I was about 5 or 6. Mm-hmm. And that introduced me to Disneyland with our first trip to the park. Subsequent to that, a big feature of life back in the 60s was the Sunday show that Walt would put on, The Wonderful World of Color. Mm-hmm. And loved, you know, Charlie the Lonesome Cougar, all the shows that he would put on Sunday night. But the ones that would be especially important to me, and this is as a kid of single-digit years, and even as a early teenager, were the ones that talked about WED, visited WED, visited the parks, and the like. Even after Walt died, they still had, for example, the Osmond brothers going to Disneyland at night.
Yeah.
And on the Sunday show. And that was, I tell you, I'd give my left elbow for that, because there was no recording of these shows, right?
No.
The best you could do was pick up a repeat in the spring and the summer. So if you missed it, you missed it. So Sunday was, it was Disney night in our house. Mm. And I even remember when Walt died in 66, my father, every night we'd get home from work, he would turn the TV around and face the dining room table and watch Walter Cronkite deliver the evening news. Mm. And during Walter's half hour, he also had Eric Sebride come on and make some commentary. And I absolutely remember the commentary, even though I never understood what Eric Sebride said the rest of the time, mm-hmm. the night he talked about Walt Disney, I still remember it. Mm-hmm. You know, comparing what Walt did with, you know, life in the 60s where, you know, flying elephants were as real as intercontinental ballistic missiles.
Right.
So WED was introduced to me through the Sunday shows, and it started to tweak me in the direction that my life would take. Mm-hmm. A little bit deeper into the 60s, 1967, Carousel of Progress opens. My grandparents came out from Minnesota to visit us, and they took us to Disneyland. The post show to that attraction, which was brought in from the World's Fair in New York, was the large model of Epcot.
Oh, yeah.
When I got to the top of that ramp at the end of the revolving show presentation, I could not believe what I saw. A city of the future, a star-shaped city, mm-hmm. Center core, multi-story building at the center core, pie-shaped wedges with laced with transportation monorails, people movers. It, you know, if you look for a definition of sustainability visibly, that certainly was it. It looked healthy, it looked safe, it looked fantastic. Mm-hmm. And that tweaked me to wanting to help Mr. Disney, who was dead at that point, help his organization deliver with, be part of that project. And a year later in 68, I caught the measles.
Oh.
And my aunt was visiting from Minnesota. She took my brothers, not me because I'm sick, to the park. I stayed home, and I was just totally frustrated because I would miss a chance to see the Carousel of Progress model again and see Disneyland again. I mean, I had one of those great early Sam McKinn souvenir maps.
Oh, yeah.
And I would mark it up with a ballpoint pen saying, I'm going to go here next. I'm going to look at this. And it was filled with just rich ideas of future attractions, Edison Square, and a whole bunch of stuff going on in the area that Pirates of the Caribbean would eventually occupy. And that day, even though I had a fever, even though I was miserable, I got out my HO train set, my blocks, toys, and I basically in the living room, my folks, I was latchkey, so I was staying home from school that day, missing the trip to Disneyland too. And I built Disneyland in the living room with the HO train circling it, and it felt natural to me. It felt, I loved the way I was tasking myself to organize the space. I loved the layout. I saw the radiating spokes coming out from the hub, Main Street, Fantasyland, the castle. All this was built in the living room floor.
Yeah.
And it just, I had a virus. I had Disney virus. And that told me, as I was in high school, that I need to become an architect, again, to work on Epcot, help deliver Disney's dream. Mm. that takes me into the 70s, where I'm going to Cal Poly Pomona, working on my architecture degree. And my folks, at that point, were living in Chino. We moved out from Long Beach. They had a feed store and small little ranch in Artesia originally. Then they moved out to Chino when all the dairies moved out there. And one day I'm in the pasture with my dad. We're dehorning and vaccinating some calves. And he says, "You want to work for Disney, right?" "Yeah." "Go get a job at Disneyland." "Okay." And the next day I'm at Harbor House interviewing with Jim Lohman. And that gentleman, as he sees me walk in with long hair, mustache, bell bottoms, tank top, he looks at me and says, "I got to tell you right off the bat, none of that." I go, "No problem. I will cut my hair. I will cut the mustache. None of that is a problem." "Okay, but there's no jobs in operations." I said, "Not a problem. I will cook your burgers, sweep your streets, put your Pooh Bears on the shelf. I need to develop a good work record here at Disneyland so I can transfer to WED when I graduate Cal Poly." He goes, "What?" I said, "I'll cook your burgers, sweep your streets, put your Pooh Bears on the shelf because I need a great work record from here so I can transfer to WED when I graduate." He looks at me, stares at me, picks up the phone, talks with someone on the other end and says, "Do you still have that job?" Hangs up the phone, turns to me and says, "Would you like to drive the monorail?" I said, "That would be fine."
Yeah.
And so I interviewed at Retlaw, which was the Disney family's company that took care of their investment interests, but also operated the steam train and monorail at Disneyland. Passed through the interview process there and went into training at $1.76 an hour for 4 days.
Wow. About what, yeah. About what year was that when you got hired in?
75.
75, okay.
But after those 4 days, my wage stepped up to $2.34 an hour.
Nice.
Okay. The 4 days of training, there's about 100 dial switch gauges, buttons on the monorail. In those 4 days, your foreman, who serves as a trainer, rides with you, takes you through every one of them, and it's a 3x5 card test where he's constantly drilling you on what does this do? What does circuit breaker number 21 do? How much PSI do you need to operate the brakes? What's a dead man switch? How do you open the tail cone door? You know, you're just, it's an incredible training process delivered by some really incredible people who knew their stuff.
Yeah.
And then I've been thinking about whether I mentioned this or not, but I think I'm going to. The first day I'm out of training, I show up for my shift. It's 1 o'clock in the afternoon where I turn my time card in up at the counter or council. I go down to the turnstile and start my first shift at tickets. You'll rotate through several positions before you drive the train. You start at tickets, then you go up to the platform, help load, then you drive the train, then you get off the hotel, then you drive the train back, you take a break. So started at tickets, and this is sort of a God moment because it impacted my life and that of a guest. I sent 104 guests through the turnstile as I should, saying thank you as I take the e-ticket. It's the day of the, it's the era of the e-ticket. And then I cut my line, please wait here. I lock the turnstiles. I turn around to dutifully watch guests going up the speed ramp to make sure no one trips or falls because there's a dead man switch at the base of the ramp I hit if someone falls and I need to stop the ramp. I see movement out of the right side of my eye. I turn. I see a 12-year-old boy walking on the monorail beam. Monorail yellow is in the station. It's sort of a cork in the bottle. He's not walking in that direction, I guess because monorail yellow is in the station. He can't get to the platform. He's walking toward the Matterhorn. I turn to my council. There's an intercom switch. I mash it, trying to get the foreman. I mash it, just hit it, and I'm saying, kill the power, kill the power, kill the power. That's the first thing I want to do.
Yeah.
Monorail yellow's in the station. It's being unloaded. The foreman is helping unload it. He's away from the council. It may be buzzing, but there's no one there. I see the kid still moving. I got to get that power off, and I want the kid not to walk any further in case he could fall.
Yeah.
So I step out. I spread open my arms, and I gently say, hey, kid, stay where you are. He jumps. he jumps onto the hot side of the beam. And at this point, I'm not going to bother with the mashing of the intercom trying to raise the crew at the top. I start running up the speed ramp, screaming at the top of my lungs, kill the power, kill the power, kill the power. Mm-hmm. And as I do that, I'm looking back toward where the kid had jumped. And there's a canopy underneath the beam in the Tomorrowland area to stop rain from falling on guests. He's standing on that canopy. He's not touched the bus bar. He looks like Kilroy to me because I just see his head above the monorail beam. And now I yell at him and say, grab the people mover railing and don't you move. Mm-hmm. Grab it and don't you move. Kill the power. Kid, don't move. Hold on to that railing. Kill the power. The guests in front of me are now starting to yell, kill the power. A foreman or another crew team member up on the platform kills the power. And eventually they pull the kid off of from the people mover side, stop that attraction and lift the kid out and off. So the backstory there is it was 1 o'clock when I started my shift. His parents had told him he needed to be back at the hotel at 12 o'clock. He was on the people mover at that time. He's passing by the monorail station. He sees the monorail, knows that's the path back to the hotel. Somehow gets off the people mover, somehow climbs over the railing, the catwalk, and gets onto the monorail beam. Yellow's in the station again, so he can't walk. So that's where he and I met.
Yeah.
On my first shift after training.
Wow.
As I got hot washed later on the after action report when everything happened, I just remember asking my supervisor at the end of the day, is it always this way around here?
Yeah.
Thank God the answer is no.
Yeah, exactly.
But that taught me an incredible lesson that I took to WED and on to Imagineering and beyond with. You know, guests are amazing. They are really amazing. And sometimes you can't underthink what they might possibly do. Mm-hmm. And every attraction, park, area I work on, I always imagine what is the craziest thing a guest could do in this situation and how do we defeat them from doing that.
Yeah.
It stayed with me for the rest of my life, as well as the 20 cc's of adrenaline mm-hmm. that shot into my system that afternoon.
Wow.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it's not a, as cast members or even if, you know, you're working at Imagineering, you become extremely familiar with the facilities and, you know what's where and how things operate and all that sort of thing. But to guests, it's, you know, especially if it's their first time there, you know, they might be completely disoriented, you know, and they're not thinking about it. You know? So
that's where we come in to help them.
Yeah.
But I'm a registered architect, and like at the AIA convention about 20 years ago, I sit down at lunchtime at the common tables with other architects. We're talking. They find out from Disney, and they one of the other architects says, "Well, what are you working on right now?" And I said, "Well, to be truthful, it's just a gate I'm working on." A pass-through gate for a parade and cast members. Oh, what's the big deal about something like that? You know, you just want to make sure it's safe. Mm-hmm. You know, a guest doesn't pinch their finger, you know, by accident. Oh, what? And then he said, well, the chance of that happening is 1 out of 1,000,000. And then I told him this. I said, well, it just happens. This gate is on Main Street Euro Disneyland. Mm-hmm. And if it's like Disneyland in California or Florida, you'll have anywhere from 12 to 15 million people walk up Main Street to start their day and 12 or 15 million people coming down Main Street during the course of year. That's 30 times a year, if I use your number of 1 out of 1,000,000 chance, that's 30 times a year that someone loses their finger.
Wow.
And he became silent.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's the serious stuff of our business, but... Mm-hmm. It's a joy to work. I've thought about going down to the park. I live in Sierra Madre, California. But with travel times, like I would love to drive the monorail again. I don't care if they pay me $1.76 again. Hell, I'll pay them $1.76 to drive that train again and do that job again. It was fantastic. Although I do have a preference for the old Mark III monorails, because the pilot and two guests sat up on top in a dome.
Oh, yeah.
My favorite seat up there, you know. Just absolutely. clear the people mover track by an inch or two, you know. I mean, you know.
Yep. Yep. Exactly. I mean, it was a dream job.
And how long did you do that for?
Did it for about 3.5 years.
Okay.
And I think, like a lot of people of that time, or maybe even still today, I had 3 or 4 jobs. Mm-hmm. Working at the park was just one of them.
Wow.
I'd come home and I'd either feed, depending upon my shift, I would feed calves on my folks' ranch in the morning or feed them at night. They also had a small feed store, and I would make deliveries for them on my days off. Mm-hmm. And during the summer, I also got job up in Oxnard on my days off with a contractor doing spec housing. So I was young, stupid, didn't know that 3 or 4 jobs, you know, I don't want to do that today.
Yeah.
But back then, it's just something you did. But I didn't have any. When I graduated, I had no college debt. I had $1,500 in the bank, and you know, it was. And I had great experiences, a lot of learning behind me.
So you were there when Space Mountain was being built and opened, right?
You have a good memory. Yeah, absolutely.
Well, I know my history.
The day I started, they had finished the excavation for the big bowl in the ground,
mm-hmm.
and they had started to core drill what would be the columns that would hold up the tension ring.
Right.
The lower ring is called a tension ring, and the higher ring at the very top is called a compression ring. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, I got to see it was under construction the full time I was there. And got to be one of the first cast. Got to be the human sandbag.
That must have had an effect on you too. Seeing, you know, as an architect in training, you know, at that time in school, and seeing something like that being built—that's not a normal building, you know.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I couldn't see it enough. Mm-hmm. And it was great. And I also have to confess, I'd already been a wed stalker. I really became a wedge stalker at that point.
Yeah.
So what do I mean by that? I would drive into 1401 Flower Street, particularly in the evenings during winter. Mm-hmm. I'd get in there about 6 or 7 o'clock, the sun's down, and the lights on the Gold Coast. Gold Coast was where the executive sat, ground floor, facing on Flower Street. Mm-hmm. And a lot of these guys had their blinds open. And I would basically park across the street or on the building side of the street, and I had binoculars, and I'm looking into the lit offices,
yeah,
of Marty Sklar, John Hinch, Claude Coates, Dick Klein, all those greats who lined that row, and seeing the artwork that they put up on the wall, because their walls were covered with stuff. Mm-hmm. And I also took my first $400 that I earned at Disneyland, and I bought 20 shares of Disney stock so I could get the annual report.
Oh.
And then also about halfway through my college experience in architecture school, I came across a telephone book in the Cass Brink area next to Space Mountain. And the great thing was it listed names and what department the individuals were in. And so I sort of borrowed that telephone book, you might say.
Yeah.
And started cold calling anybody that had architecture after their name. And just asking for a courtesy interview. Mm-hmm. And finally, a gentleman by the name of Dave Jacobs said, okay, yeah, come on in. And I brought in, so at that point, it was third year of a fourth year architecture degree. And I had my school work. And for my dad and some of his clients, I was doing calf barns, cattle barns. So I take all this in. I sit down with Dave. I share with him my school work. I share with him cattle barns. And mention, of course, I'm working for Rutlaw at Disneyland, driving the monorail, getting good operations experience and the like. And at the end of it, He goes, you know, I have to be honest, we don't have any jobs right now. And I said, that's okay. I'm not looking for one until I graduate in I think it was 2 years at that point. Mm-hmm. He goes, what? Yeah, I just wanted to let you know I'm in the pipeline. I'm coming your way. Looking forward to working with you. And just wanted to, you know, get my hat in the ring, foot in the door. He just stared at me sort of the same way Jim Lohman stared at me at Harbor House. Now, there's a story after that, though. Fast forward to 1979, 1980. Mm-hmm. I was the first of five people put on the Tokyo Disneyland project after the contract with Oriental Land Company was signed. Mm-hmm. And my boss, Frank Stanek, was mobilizing the design team for that effort. And because of Epcot and Tokyo underway, people were being stretched. Mm-hmm. People were really being stretched. It's a wonderful thing. I went in as an entry-level person, and this man stretched me beyond limits I even could have comprehended. I'll give you an example. The first meeting on Tokyo Disneyland I had, he said, I'll chair this. Come with me. We went over to the Tahunga building, where he was able to scrounge out some space for the Tokyo team, because, again, Epcot was the big beast on the floors. And at that meeting, he ran it for an hour, and I watched how he ran it. And then we walked out the door and to the parking lot to his car, and he says, you know that meeting we just had? Yeah. He goes, that's the last time I'm managing it. You're doing it from now on. Okay. The next meeting I chair, our team grew a little bit, and the lead for the architecture effort walks in, and it's Dave Jacobs, the man who gave me the cold call interview a couple years earlier. I don't say anything to Dave because I don't think he remembers me, and I'm back to my long hair at this point anyway, mm-hmm. and mustache. And anyway, we go through the next 2 years working very closely together. I'm sort of coordinator, design manager. I'm setting up the schedule, the delivery, the resource planning. He's leading the actual technical team. I'm leading design reviews of his work and the like. And it wasn't until he retired in the 90s, late 90s, that I actually walked up to him and I said, Dave, do you remember interviewing a kid who brought a whole bunch of college work and a whole bunch of cattle barns to show you a courtesy call? Oh, yeah. I go, Dave, that was me. And he just, his eyes got big. He goes, he never said anything. I didn't think you remembered me. He goes, I can't believe it. Anyway, that was, it was such a wonderful moment. I thought I was nobody from Kokomo, so I didn't try to say, hey, Dave, you know. Yeah. And, but we worked closely. He taught me a bunch. He and Stanek and others, like Don Ingren, Walt's chief engineer, they grew me very quickly.
So working at WED, did you have the opportunity to meet any of those people that you were stalking early on?
Yeah, Tony Baxter, mm-hmm. Claude Coates, Mark Davis, Harper Goff. Harper, I initially was brought in. Let me tell you how I was brought in. Uh-huh. It's break time from the monorail. I go to the cast area in May of 78. And on the wall, they had jobs that were posted. One of them was at WED for a research analyst. And it's the job description is a person who writes a narrative, writes a scope of work that estimators on Epcot and Tokyo Disneyland will use to price things. You know, how many AA figures in the scene? How many scenes? How many special effects? What's the nature of this scene? How many square footage in the shop or the show building? They needed someone to do takeoffs, to work with the creative team, to summarize what they were envisioning and put all that in written form and diagrammatic form for estimators to price. I said, I can do that. So I put my hat in the ring, and Frank Stanek, who was the project manager for both Epcot and Tokyo Disneyland at the time, came down to the park, interviewed me on one of my breaks, and ended up hiring me. Quite literally, in June of 78, I got my diploma on Saturday from Cal Poly. On Sunday, I drove the monorail for the last time, and on Monday, I turned out at the studio for my orientation and started work at WED.
Wow. Amazing.
And so I was living the dream, gentlemen.
Yeah.
I mean, the 13-year-old kid who built, you know, Disneyland in his living room got his foot in the door. Well, I got to tell you one other story, too.
Yeah.
So it's another God moment. It's like God loves it when you plan so much of your life, right? Mm-hmm. I always asked myself, as I was going through college, I said, what would be a sign of success that I've made it, I've reached it, I've got to where I've asked the Lord to be? Mm-hmm. And one of my favorite actors was Charlton Heston. Just loved the movie Ben-Hur, a lot of his work. And he lived on Coldwater Canyon. He had an incredible house he had designed back in the early 60s. And so I told myself, you know, here are the two barometers that will tell me if I'm successful. I'm living on Coldwater Canyon Drive, and I've got the key to WED in my pocket. A key to WED. Mm-hmm. Those two things. And that's how I sort of categorized or defined, Lord, I've made it. Thank you much.
Yeah.
So the Tokyo project, again, was looking for space, competing with Epcot. And in 1979, after I started, my boss, Frank Stanek, said, okay, temporarily we're going to set up in this building. It was the 1048 building on Grand, near the old Airway building. Hmm. And he said, no one's in there right now. You're going to be the first person there. It was a warehouse with a couple of offices. And he goes, they're issuing you a key to the building. Okay. And so, bang, check. I go, oh, okay, well, I did get my key to the building, to this large, empty warehouse building. And the second one was I moved from Chino because the commute was killing me.
Yeah.
An hour and a half on the 210. And my buddies who were going to UCLA, three of us scrounged together and found a tiny apartment. Guess on what street? Not up in the hills of Malibu, you know, but down in the valley on Coldwater Canyon. Oh. Check.
Yep, yep. Wow. Amazing.
But you want some stories of life on the monorail?
Absolutely.
Yeah, anything. Okay. Yeah.
I'm going to give you two or three. Here's a cute one. So going over the parking lot, heading toward the hotel, there's a dad and his little daughter riding up front with me. They're in the two seats in front of me. Mm-hmm. And she's three-ish, I guess. And I tell her, because it's nighttime and the fireworks are about to start, and I tell her, hey, look over there toward the Matterhorn. You'll see Tinkerbell. You're going to see Tinkerbell fly. And a few seconds later, spotlight goes on. There goes Tinkerbell. And in like two or three seconds after she launches, there go the fireworks. Kaboom, kaboom, kaboom. Great view from the monorail up there, looking back at the park. And she screams out, Daddy, they're trying to shoot down Tinkerbell. Oops. Oops. Now, you guys probably know that from your time in the park, too, it's sort of like the Army. There's long periods of, I don't want to call it boredom, especially on slow days.
Downtime.
Downtime, and you're working, and there's not much happening.
Right.
And then there's moments of, holy crap.
Mm-hmm.
And so one night at the hotel, I was closing up. Tickets had closed up about 15 minutes earlier. And there was only one or two trains left to pass through. And so I'm locking things up and closing things up. And this gentleman who's in chic clothes and the like robes walks up with these two big bruisers with him. Mm-hmm. And bruiser number one says to me, he wants to ride in the tail cone. Because back then we sold tickets where you could do a round trip from the hotel with a $1.25 ticket you buy. You could go in the tail cone and get that ride into and out of the park. Mm-hmm. Doesn't let you off in the park. It just brings you back to the hotel. And he wanted to ride that. And the ticket seller's gone. There's only one or two trains left, so I have no tickets to sell them. I can't let them on. I said, I'm really sorry. We just closed a few minutes ago. Mm-hmm. There are no, There's no one selling tickets and the like. And the bruiser, number one, turns to the sheik and tells him that. And by the way, it's not that we're not used to seeing bodyguards. No, I mean, yeah. Usually they're State Department. And we drive over the main gate, and between Harbor House and the main gate, you'd see all the Suburbans where the Secret Service would bring in Prince so-and-so or King so-and-so or whoever so-and-so, right? Mm-hmm. These guys weren't State Department guys. It was a dude with his bodyguards. Anyway, the sheik fellow says something in language I don't understand. Back to bruiser number one. Bruiser number two, his head is on a swivel. He just keeps looking around. Bruiser number one comes back to me, and in the motion in which he's pulling back his coat jacket, he's reaching into as he's pulling back his coat jacket. And I see, well, there were two things there, that his hand is going actually happily for a Jed Clampett wad of $20 bills. Okay. Mm-hmm. It's about 2 inches around with a rubber band around it. And that's what he pulls out of his coat. But I see slung inside his coat is an Uzi with a mag attached.
Ooh.
Right. And he pulls out the Jed Clampett wad, holds it out to me, and he says, take whatever you want. He really wants to go on the ride. And at my $2.34 rate, I say to him, I'm really, really, really sorry. I have no tickets to sell. You've got to come back tomorrow. With that, bruiser number one explains it to the sheik again, who yells something, and they leave.
Wow.
Anyway.
Wow.
Another time I was walking up, I was walking up to a turnstile in Tomorrowland for my break, and one of the ride operators at the turnstile was working the line, and I hear her say, "Will the little boy playing fireman on the railing, please step off the railing?" A mom was holding her little 2 or 3 year old boy up on the railing. He was standing on the railing, peeing into the submarine lagoon. So I thought she used the perfect words for Disneyland. With a little boy playing fireman, please reel it in.
Yep, reel it in. That's funny.
No, but it was terrific to work there late night.
Yeah.
Go for Mari's Pizza afterwards. Or, you know, the band was there. Jump up in the tomorrow. Oh, man, it was great. They were pretty good at tribute songs. Mm-hmm. When Sunshine Blue would do some of Fleetwood Mac stuff, man, I was in heaven. Anything Stevie Nick, man, it was great.
So you did some projects. You mentioned Tokyo.
Relocated to Tokyo 3 different times. Mm-hmm. The first one was for the original Tokyo Disneyland project. Mm-hmm. And so there was a ton of learning on that, how to do a theme park.
Right.
And do it overseas. The second time relocated to Tokyo was to put in Toontown. Duplicate of what you have here in California. And the third time was I was the project manager, project architect, design manager for American Waterfront portion of Tokyo Disney Seas. And I love, Tokyo is wonderful. People are wonderful. Projects are wonderful. Orient Company only builds the best.
Mm-hmm.
Their quality is what they want. Quality is what we give them. And then domestically, you were asking about Disneyland. I was the design manager for the Indiana Jones project there.
Okay.
And so we're working with Tony Baxter, Eddie Sato, some incredibly talented people. And also my final project before I retired, and I left before it finished, I was the lead design manager for both of the Galaxy's Edge, the Star Wars lands in California and Florida.
Oh, nice.
As well as the original, the initial design manager for the realignment of the Rivers of America, too. So, lots of good stuff.
Yeah, that is. I like the layout of Galaxy's Edge. I was talking earlier that I think that it's good to have that, how it has three entrances now, And you could, when Fantasmic's going on, you could actually use that to get around the crowds by going through Galaxy's Edge and like through Critter and then out through the Fantasyland right beyond the trail there. Just kind of.
Yes.
Yep. I like the layout, yeah.
A lot of people don't realize how many times we iterate those master plans. Mm-hmm. For Disneyland, the Star Wars land, actually, we worked for a year. Mm-hmm. Trying to shoehorn it into Tomorrowland.
Yeah.
And it just too hard. In the end, Tom Staggs, I think, said, find a different site. Mm-hmm. And because we just couldn't deliver a great product. It was too big of an idea to fit in the land.
I saw that big model at D23 Expo. That was pretty amazing. Huge model.
Yes.
Yeah.
Beautiful model.
Yes. Yeah. Really neat.
So you said you relocated to, you went to Tokyo three times for those three different projects?
Correct. So I've lived in Japan probably 5 to 6 years.
Wow.
If you combine all three times. On Paris, I was the stateside project manager. So about $200 million plus dollars worth of services and goods were coming out of the U.S. Mm-hmm. And my job was to get them done and get them over to France and report on that progress. So for 2 years, I was getting on a plane once a month and going to Paris for about a week to a week and a half each time. I was in jet lag for 2 years solid.
Yes.
Wow. But it was fantastic. Every night when I'd leave the site, I'm driving back on the A4 toward Paris, and the Eiffel Tower is lit up. It's 20 miles away from you, but you still see it, and you go, wow, I'm in Paris.
Yeah.
This is cool. On a weekend, you work Saturdays a lot, but if I had a Saturday, Sunday, I would try to go to Normandy or go to Berlin, take a quick side trip, mm-hmm. and take advantage of being there on the continent. it's a fun job, but somebody has to do it.
Yeah.
Exactly. That's my line. Trademark. By sure.
Oh, man. So now, when you were with Retlaw, you never worked on the railroad. You're just a monorail, correct?
No, good observation. Oh. Probably half of the operators were cross-trained. I wasn't. And I sort of missed that. I was just so happy driving the monorail. I mean, I was a monorail pilot, dude.
Yeah.
I wasn't one of these conductors going along for the ride. I was driving the beast. Hey, you guys want to know a secret?
Yeah.
Yes.
Monorail Red was the fastest.
Oh.
Okay. Red was the fastest.
That's the one they turned into the Mouser Rail.
Yeah. Here's a sad story. So after coming back from Tokyo in 83, I moved into project management, and one of my first projects was the Mark V conversion. And I had to witness the demolition of yellow, green, and blues Mark III bodies.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
They were taken to basically a metal shredder, torn apart. Most of red also was torn up. The limousine used the front part of red. But I had to witness for the company the destruction of the Mark III shells. I almost cried.
Yeah. Mm. These days, they might send it to the Von Eaton galleries to be auctioned off.
Yeah. And actually, I was looking out in the desert near Las Vegas right now. Uh-huh. You know, Bombardier was licensed to make, I think, the Mark... See the Mark VI, I think they were Mark VIs, for Las Vegas on the Strip, right?
Oh.
Yeah. And those trains are no longer running. They are basically sitting out in a boneyard in the desert, and no one's bought them yet. but they're extremely similar to what you see at World.
Right.
Wow. Or saw at World. There's been an iteration of those trains since then.
Yeah.
Wow.
You know, you sound like a guy after my own heart. You know, at one point I aspired to be at Imagineering, and I totally get the stalker thing that you have talked about, or observing things when you can, you know, the phone book and the, you know, back in the day, we, before you had Google Earth, you know, Google Maps, sometimes backstage you could find an overall site plan of Disneyland. You know, this is before the resort expansion and everything. Mm-hmm. Yep. And it was always nice to make a photocopy of that. And then it's like, now if I was going to add something or change something, how would I do that? You know, and you had the actual correct dimensions of everything, you know. So that was always fun to do.
So. Yeah, I have to admit something too. So the kid who was growing up, the 13-year-old and the college student, uh-huh, always envisioned themselves as being Mark Davis, Harper Goff, Bill Martin, Tony Baxter. But in reality, I found, as I entered Imagineering, WED back then, that I had not prepared myself adequately. I did not have enough artistic skills. But I found that I had other skills: planning, organization, integration, coordination. I could see processes. I could see, especially after Tokyo Disneyland, being on that thing from womb to tomb, I could see how you build a theme park. Well, this is the first thing you do, and that's the second, here's the third. And it didn't hurt. After I realized I had other gifts that could help the company, it didn't hurt. I realized that, no, I'm not Tony Baxter. I'm not Eddie Sato. I'm not one of these folks, because they have a different set of talents than I have. But fortunately, my talents are also, and many other types of talents are needed by that type of organization. And my son actually is an Imagineer as well. And he got it. He figured it out early on that if he wanted to do what I wanted to do when I was 13 or in college, he had to develop those artistic skills, mm-hmm, those master planning skills, and the like. And he went after it and he did it. It started with the high school that he went to, Bosco Tech over in Rosemead, where instead of homeroom each semester for your 4 years, you have a technology. And he signed up for design technology. So over those 4 years, he learned mechanical drafting. He learned sketching. He learned sculpting. He learned model building. He learned AutoCAD. He learned SketchUp. He learned Revit. He learned,
wow,
he learned skills that one day my boss at Imagineering, Mike McCullough, came in my office and he saw, I had some of my son's work on the wall, and he saw it, and he told his wife about it, Tori McCullough, who is Ex-Atencio's daughter. She ran the wow, interiors group. He told her about my son. She walks in my office the next day and says, I understand your son knows how to do AutoCAD. Yeah, yeah. I need someone for the Shanghai project that's dirt cheap, and what they're going to do is a crappy job I've got, which is, in Shanghai, the government wants every square footage of drywall, ceiling tile, flooring. They want those takeoffs so they can estimate it. So she hired my son for the summer to come in, open AutoCAD files, and do takeoffs on how many square feet of drywall here, how many square feet of acoustic tile, how many square feet of whatever, 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 whatever. He did that all summer.
Wow.
And during that time, He was able to get exposure to, thanks to Tori and other people, to the Tony Baxters and the like, and hone in on what he needed to do. And one day he walks into my office and goes, hey, Dad, I figured something out. They go, what's that? I don't want your job. That's okay, because nobody's going to give it to you. No, I don't want your job. I want to be like Abe Quibeen or Oscar Cobos or Tony Baxter. I said, hey, buddy, you got to get game up. Now, understand, he's been drawing Disneyland since he was also six. Mm. It goes way back, right? Way back. He'd be saying, hey, we can use this area behind Main Street between Matterhorn, between the Space Mountain and Main Street. We could put a resort hotel in there, and it'll feed into where Edison Square's cul-de-sac was. And he'd show me a sketch and go, that's neat. Anyway, he was on a path for a long, long time, and then he saw that he had to get game up, and he did. So in subsequent summers, others came forward and said, hey, he knows Revit. I need somebody that knows Revit. Hey, I need someone to be a coordinator for this design team. And he became a concept designer at Imagineering, working on land-level projects and the like. And then during COVID, he was furloughed along with pretty much everyone else.
Yeah.
And he did a Hail Mary pass. He put an application into Notre Dame's Graduate School of City Design, which is not city design in terms of zoning and, there's a counter with a planning official behind it. Mm-hmm. It teaches you, how is Rome designed? How is Rome different from Amsterdam, different from Paris, different from Munich, different from a fishing town in Norway? It teaches you about city design in terms of designing cities. And it also emphasizes designing buildings that fit within the locality. If you go to architecture school today, and it was the same when I was in architecture school, the kids there design buildings for anywhere USA. That building would look the same in Denver, as New York, as Miami, as Finland, as in Hawaii. It has the buildings of steel, concrete, glass. They have no locality nature to them.
Generica. It's just generic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, and the other thing, too, my son and I had in common, we got hammered for wanting to work for Disney. His college professors and mine just said, it's fake architecture. It's not real. Why do you want to do that? That's not where you should go. My rebuttal to them was, oh, well, can you tell me who pays to go see your architecture? Because I'm being trained by architects, and certainly no one was paying to see their building.
Yeah, yeah.
Anyway, back to my son. So he was in concept design, and he was called back after the furlough. A lot of people weren't. Fortunately, he was called back. And a couple months after he calls back, guess what he gets in the mail? The big, thick packet from Notre Dame. Free ride, plus a TA teaching job, a stipend for it, and he accepts. So in July, he resigned from Imagineering, and he just completed his first year at Notre Dame with one more to go.
Wow.
So his path, sort of similar in terms of the intensity of desire to be an Imagineer, but he was smart enough, and he had also access to the training he needed to do the job that I wanted his job. I wanted the job that he does. And the like. But as I said, fortunately, I had other talents. And I enjoyed those talents, too. And by the way, at Imagineering, everybody has a different path into Imagineering. There's no consistent path into Imagineering.
Right.
Everyone's road is different. And also, in many cases, like mine, you're doing something different every 5 years. Every 5 years, I'm doing something dramatically different. And I was in project management assignments, design management assignments. I was a head of sustainability. I ran the architecture group as a functional manager. Every 5 years, you find yourself changing. So.
Wow. Well, Val, I think we could just keep talking to you all night, but we'll have to definitely have you back on. But what are you doing? What are you currently doing? Right, like, do you want to plug anything or what you're doing now?
Sure, shameless plug.
Yeah.
So after retiring, I set up a small company. I do consulting. And I also, through this company, write books. I've published two books on Amazon. They're a theme park series. The first one was Theme Park Project Management. Mm-hmm. That was published in February of 2020, just before COVID started. The second one, which was published last month, is called Theme Park Sustainability. And the third book, which is underway right now, is actually a novel. It's still part of the theme park series, mm-hmm. but it follows a fictional team through the mobilization period on a major project. It sort of helps illustrate, you know, the project team table, all the dynamics behind these huge, big projects that Disney tackles. And also as part of this consulting company, my son and I, when he was on furlough, we had a client back east, a county, who commissioned us to design a city of the future. Oh. And that project is still behind the curtain, so I can't mention at this point the location, but we basically designed a city of the future. Very cool.
Wow.
So I do that. I just resigned after 20 years with the California State Guard. Put in time there. Mm-hmm. I was on COVID missions, riot missions, food bank missions in the past. I resigned that. So other than being in their ready reserve pool right now, I'm pretty much done with it.
Yeah.
My last assignment was the my unit supported the special operations unit down at Los Alamitos, and I was a planning officer for that group. Mm-hmm. And I'm also certified by the state as a trainer of other architects and engineers, structural engineers, on damage assessment after earthquakes. Oh. So I've probably trained up at this point 200 or 300 architects and engineers. I've been on two missions for the state. One was Katrina, and the other one was the Sonoma fires. And last night, just because I sort of put down the military side of things mm-hmm. and sort of miss that volunteerism, last night I volunteered for our community emergency response team here in Sierra Madre. I'll be the VP of operations for that.
Okay.
So, yeah, got to keep moving.
Yeah, I like it. Well, thank you again for coming on. I really appreciate it.
Well, thank you for the interest. Happy to have done this, and hope you have some good content for your pod.
Okay. What a show, right, Ken?
Oh, wow. That was great. Really was. That was great. I mean, he lived it. He lived that's great to be able to go from being a monorail driver, which is one of the coveted positions at the resort, and then going off and, working for the Disney family, no less, because back then it was rent law, and then going off and becoming a member at WED and working on all those projects over the years. We probably could have asked him a lot more about each of those projects, but, you know, we don't want these shows to be 3 hours long.
Just 2 hours.
Yeah.
If you'd like more information on our show, you can go to thesweetspot.com, sign up for our Patreon, become a Patreon. Also, we haven't, this is where we normally would read a review for the podcast, and we read them from Apple Podcasts. And even if you don't listen through Apple Podcasts and you have an Apple account, I think you can download the app or go on your computer and go to iTunes. But you could leave a review and we will read it on our show. So that's the challenge to you is let's get, by the next episode, let's have 5 new reviews. That's a big chore, right? We're going to do it, though. We have listeners. If you've been listening for more than 2 episodes and you enjoy the show. Now, if you don't like it, I don't know why you're still listening, but if you like it,
you're a masochist.
If you like our show and you've been listening for more than 2 episodes, go on to Apple and leave a review. Let's try to get 5. That would be awesome. All right.
Leave a review, join our Patreon, buy our t-shirts from our website. You know, spread the word and tell people how they can listen to The Sweet Spot. Tell them it's on Apple Podcasts, it's on YouTube, it's, you know, it's Mice Chat, it's a lot of places.
Everywhere. All right. Well, thank you for listening. We really appreciate it.